Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the George Mackey Library. My name is Francie, and I work here at the George Mackey Library, and you guys are in for a real treat this afternoon. We have a really wonderful series of presentations this afternoon for you, and this is the second one of a set of three that we've been hosting here this month. So this talks to your sponsor. It's a joint sponsorship between George Mackey Library and the Delta Museum and Archive Society. So as I said, it produces a series of three talks by the North Delta Advisory Group, the North Delta arm of the DMAS. And today's talk is all about the Japanese of North Delta. And Nancy Damwell here is going to begin the talk to give us a context of why the Japanese came to North Delta and what their life was like before World War II. And then Len Stroh is going to tell us about the Pitcherites coming to Canada. And John McDonald and Mark Boyter will continue the story after Pearl Harbor and their internment. And Mark will continue the story of a young woman whose family was interned, and she then returned to teach here at Annieville Elementary School. So yeah, you're in for a real treat with these presentations. And just as a little note too, on February the 24th, the Heritage Fair, there's going to be a Heritage Fair at Sunbury, and it's gonna be from 10 to 4. Sunbury is Sunbury Hall. Yeah. All right. So let's give these guys a warm welcome.
Hi. I want to tell you this is the second talk. You notice the pointer? This is old school. I was a teacher for 33 years, and I don't feel quite well unless I've got my anyone who's not touched, you know, behaving or paying attention, and there will be a test at the end. This is our presentation that you're at today, and then I want to tell you there's going to be the March 3rd. And why there's a gap in the month of February is Heritage Week month. And the reason why there's a gap is because in between is the 24th, where there will be the fair, which you should go to. So I'm going to talk about the Japanese. Now, I want you to think about why you, or your parents, or your grandparents, or your great-great-great-great-grandparents left their mother country. For various reasons. It was the same for the Japanese. The Japanese didn't leave Japan because it was optimum conditions there. They left for reasons. And so why did they leave Japan? A lot of them came at the turn of the century. That is the 19th, the 20th century. And at that time, Japan was militaristic, and it was a Meiji emperor. And they introduced conscription at about 1890-something. And this meant that the farmers and the fishermen were brought along, and their sons were pressed into military service. So this made them a little uncomfortable. That's one of the reasons for leaving. But then in 1905, there was a particularly vicious war between the Russians and the Japanese. And at the end of the war, and everybody in the Western world was surprised because Japan won against Russia. And then at the end of the war, Japanese soldiers were sent home. And when they got home, like many soldiers who go to war, they didn't feel they wanted to fit into their old life as the son of a farmer or back into fishing. So what they did was they packed up and they took off and went to Canada. Why BC? Why come to British Columbia? Why come to Canada? Well, the Chinese came first, and they called British Columbia the Golden Mountain. And for the Japanese, it was rather that way too, in that it was a place of golden opportunity, or so they thought. Some came with the gold rush, but that was a very few in number. A lot of them came at the turn of the century, as I mentioned, during the conflict that was going on in Japan, and that they wanted to leave. This is the Empress of Japan, and it was a CPR ship, and it carried silk from the Orient. And they were the ones who brought Japanese oranges so that every child in British Columbia could have one of those stuffed in the toe of their stocking. They also served as an opportunity to spread the word about Canada and about particularly about British Columbia. This is a certificate for head tax that's $500. The reason why I have it here is because the Chinese labor was no longer cheap. It used to be that the employer would sponsor the employee to come over from China, and then they would be indentured. Well, that was no longer cheap because it was $500. And put it into perspective, at that time, $500 would have been a high school teacher's yearly salary. And you could hire a laborer at $1 a day. So $500 was a lot of money. But so, of course, the employers turned to recruiting Japanese. This is Robert Dunsmuir. And this is his castle that he built. And he built it because he was a coal baron. And he came along and built the castle out of the money that he got. And one of the things he figured out was he sent people to recruit to Japan and recruit new employees. So he started it. Then the other companies, the lumber companies and the canneries caught on to this, and they hired the Nippon Supply Company, and they started hiring, importing and recruiting from Japan as well. In 1900, 2,000 Japanese were involved in the fishing industry at that point. And those were people that were living on the Fraser. Okay. Let's move along. This is at the Port of Vancouver. And, oh, it's actually Victoria. But you can see these are some of the Japanese immigrants that are coming across. And the significant thing to look at here is that there's only one woman. Okay? If these were all men who were in their 20s. Typical of new immigrants to send first the young men along who came, and then they would get their families later. Or they're, in their minds, they just wanted to come and make a lot of money and then go back to Japan. Asians were paid one half to one quarter compared to white labor. There was a recession during this time, between on and off in 1903 to 1907. And as a result of there were poor markets, and so employers sought to hire and recruit Japanese labor. So this was another reason that a lot of Japanese, it was employers recruiting. there was resentment, and the resentment was that white labor thought that the Japanese were poaching jobs. They weren't looking at the fact that they were being imported by, recruited by the employers. In 1907, 11,000 immigrants from Japan landed. Can you imagine that the lower mainland at that time was about, that's including us out here as well, about 300,000 people. And to have 11,000 people arrive looking for jobs and looking for homes was really an impact. On September 7th of 1907, there was a protest parade organized to protest all of these immigrants coming, and it turned into a riot. They carried on through Chinatown and broke windows and caused mayhem, beat people up, and then finally they hit Japantown, that's on Powell Street. But the thing is that these were veterans of the Russo-Japanese War. They had skills, and so they stood and they were ready to fight. And the crowd backed off. So that was happened. It was stopped. This is in North Delta, and they were hired in the fish industry. A lot of them were recruited. The company's dories would be towed out, and they would be out there all day fishing. They had very long hours. They had poor pay. They lived in bunk houses, and they scraped together money to buy dories. They had to pay off their employers first if they were sponsored. Okay. I'll just talk about the, what happened in North Delta was that fishing, by the time 1919 came along, there was a drop in the fishing industry. The reason why is that at Point Roberts, there were fish traps set up by the Americans. And as a result, it interrupted the migratory routes of the fish coming into the Fraser, and so the fishing decreased. Another reason that it was a difficult time on the Fraser was that there was too many fishing licenses issued, and 50% of them were out for Japanese. So they were reduced, and they were reduced down to 16% of the number of fishing licenses for the Japanese. So there was a number of Japanese who had to find new jobs, new way of making money. Some of them stayed in fishing, and they fished for ground fish, such as sole and cod, which they used for the the fish markets, in the stores. But some started up poultry farming and berry farms. And the poultry farms were in North Delta. And this is an example of, Furutani, the family. And this picture was taken in 1923. And that's how they raised Strawberry Hill. The reason why it's called Strawberry Hill is because they grew strawberries and other berries, which they sold at the local market. Most of the Japanese came in their 20s, and they stayed in bunkhouses. This is an example of a bunkhouse that would be typical. And this is where they would be day after day, and when they'd come back from being out on their dories. There was a lot of gambling, there was a lot of drinking, and there was a lot of fighting. But when women started to arrive, it created a calm. And that's what Len is going to tell us about. He is going to tell us about future brides.
I didn't realize you were finished, Nancy.
Yes, I am. There we are.
Just momentarily.
Okay. Here we go. Just push this button here.
Okay. So I don't have as many slides
there,
as Nancy.
There you go.
Here's the first one there. Well, thank you very much, Nancy, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Before I start my presentation, oh, maybe I should have the pointer. My father used this to great excess in the classroom.
It's upside down.
Anyway, I know this lady's name here. It's not really central to my presentation, but I just wanted to start with a typical picture bride so that you knew what they looked like. Dressed very elegantly in traditional Japanese apparel, you can see that she's quite appealing. A very pretty lady, and I'm sure that she would have been a lucky find for any man who would have it. Japanese picture brides, I think Nancy alluded to it earlier, they started to arrive in Canada about 1905. She also alluded to the fact that Japanese immigration started actually in the later part of the 19th century. And they were primarily men. She also alluded to that as well, although there's one lady that we saw in the These men actually never really intended to stay in Canada. It was theirs to work hard, make some money, and return back to Japan with greater financial security. About a decade later, many of them felt that Canada wasn't really all that bad after all, and they decided to stay. And the ones that decided to stay were facing a dilemma, of course. What to do about a bride, because they were still hung up on the Japanese tradition where marriages were family matters arranged by heads of households through a mediator or a conciliator. Well, this was not going to fly in Canada, of course, because we didn't operate that way, not yet anyway. So these gentlemen resorted to what they called the Japanese picture bride because it was a viable alternative to what they were used to. All that was required with the Japanese picture bride was an exchange of photographs with a very minimum of other forms of communication. So Japanese picture brides were great, but they were subject to the provisions.
There's the heat.
Oh, I see. You just pointed out. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, right. That's actually later on anyway. But Japanese picture brides were products of the Meiji era dynasty. Actually, Nancy referred to that as well. Just briefly, I might say that the Meiji era dynasty was essentially the last one that governed Japan. And the ladies were products of that, but as you know probably, the dynasties were governing Japan for centuries before. It was a very paternalistic society. They basically were a feudal state up until the end of the 19th century. The Japanese picture brides were also subject to a certain morality that was all women had to behave in a certain way. And this morality involved basically, as I said, paternalism. Basically, they had to be devoted to family and duty because they were considered very, very high priorities. If you're thinking about love and affection, well, that's right at the bottom of the list. That wasn't really too important, although I guess when you look at some of the Japanese picture brides, you'd wonder why not. Basically, subservience, obedience, and self-denial were all considered the highest of virtues in a Japanese picture bride. Happiness, well, that probably was forgotten on the boat coming over because that was considered selfish behavior in the Japanese picture brides. Theirs was to look after themselves and the needs of their children. Because basically their life, once they were married through the arranged system, they were basically property of the husband, being this paternalistic state. This picture up here is Taki Koizumi and her husband. I've forgotten her name actually, but his name, I'm sorry. But she was a Japanese picture bride that arrived in Canada in 1919. She had led a very sheltered existence in Japan, and she had attended an all-girls college prior to becoming a Japanese picture bride. She and her husband initially went to a small fishing village on the Skeena River up north. I don't know how long they were there. Let's just say they were there for about 3, 4, or 5 years before coming to North Delta. Her husband became a fisherman, not too surprising, and she worked seasonally in a fish cannery. Now get this as an example of paternalism. In the evenings, she had to wash men's clothes at 10 cents a load. Her husband was away during the daytime, of course, all the time, and she had to assume operation of a 10-acre farm with the help of her children, selling, well, basically raising chickens and the produce. So it basically was a quite an arduous existence for any Japanese picture bride who had to assume those kinds of responsibilities. I'm assuming that school was fit in there somewhere, because we did have schools in North Delta at that time. This would be in the 20s, and they would have had to fit that in somehow. Now, regrettably, in 1938, Taki's husband passed away. Now, this, of course, added to the burden of how she was going to survive in North Delta. She had to resort to the farm produce, chickens, farm produce, and sell that to the community. And basically, that was the sole source of income, because she no longer had a husband. John will be, of course, speaking about the internment later on. But next slide. Okay. Just as an added feature, I wanted to show you a couple of pictures of other Japanese picture brides and their husbands. This was Matsuyu and Suya Nagamori. They lived, actually she was introduced to Matsuyu through a mediator who had arranged a marriage in Japan, but his friend here in North Delta knew about this lady because she was attending a finishing school in Japan. They were introduced by letter, arranged a marriage in Japan, they exchanged pictures, other forms of communications like letter, and that was basically it. And where did they live? They actually lived on Newton Road, which is now 72nd Avenue in Surrey, and where they raised chickens and, as Nancy referred to earlier, grew strawberries. Another Japanese picture bride, this is Katishi Akida, and his picture bride, Kisame. Like the Masajiros, like the Nagamoris, they also lived on 72nd Avenue or Newton Road, where they raised chickens and grew strawberries. So it's quite evident why that area over there is known as Strawberry Hill. To basically conclude, about 1924, there were approximately over 6,000 Japanese picture brides who had come to Canada. Japanese immigration by the late 20s had been seriously curtailed. There weren't as many Japanese allowed to emigrate from Japan to Canada. And this also affected the Japanese picture brides because the program was essentially over by 1928. In fact, the Japanese picture brides, like I said, over 6,000, yes, but they were no longer considered any part of the immigrant ranks to Canada. Now, there's a heck of a lot more I can say about Japanese picture brides, but you'll have your opportunity to ask questions later. So I'm going to now turn it over to John McDonald.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
No. I'm just going to click on here and say, John is the author of these pictures. And he has organized these pictures to show you where people lived. Very interesting. Do you want this? You want to go wander?
I've got this. So this shows where the Japanese families in North Delta lived. Most of them lived here on Daly Road, which is now 88th, on Gibson, 90th, or 92nd was Laurel Road. At that time, the only north-south streets were Scott Road and Oliver Road. This map shows Park Road because it's actually a 1950s map. And this is the old East Electric Railway Station here, the Kennedy Station. This is the Kennedy School that was on 90th Avenue, the Kennedy Hall. And there was a Japanese school, I think, in one of the homes here on Daly Road at 88th. And that would be right about where the Kennedy Senior Center is today. And these were all area was subdivided into 5-acre lots. The farmers had 5 and 10-acre farms. The Koizumi family, number 23 here, they were on Bailey Road at about 150, and they had 5 acres with 2,000 chickens. They grew strawberries, apples, cherries, plums, pears, raspberries, gooseberries, and currants. And the first name here, I can say his name right, Macho Ichi
Okamura.
Masajiro. Okay, Okamura. They lived on Nahora Road here, at what is now the corner of 116th. He was a member of the Strawberry Hill Farmers Institute, which is still down here on 75A Street. And he was also a member of the Strawberry Hill Berry Growers Association. But today we think of Strawberry Hill as being centered down here around 75A. But the Strawberry Hill Post Office was here at 80th or Gray Avenue and Scott Road. And that served both North Delta and Surrey right across up into past the Cedar Hills area. If you ask these people in 1941 and part of 42 where they lived, they would have said Strawberry Hill, and that was their postal address. So the suburban lot subdivisions that we have today, like Kennedy Heights and Royal Heights, they just didn't exist in the district. Is the next map. Okay, and so this is another map with some names. If you've ever been to the Shelter Island Marina off Westminster Highway on Gray Bar Road, and you would have looked across at Dawn Island and Line Island. For the Japanese that lived there, they were known as Sato Island and Oikawa Island. And Dawn Island was named after Genzaburo Oikawa. He returned to Japan in 1906 to help 80 men and 3 women come to Canada. They were what we now call boat people. They left Japan to escape the poverty there after the war in 1905 with Russia. Their ship, the Suiyan Maru, was headed to here, to Dawn and Line Islands, but they landed near east of Victoria on Vancouver Island. They were later arrested, but they had separated into smaller groups. They hadn't attracted too much attention, and they were eventually allowed to stay. Most of these settlers were fishermen, and most would have lived on float homes. There was some farming here on Lion Island next to the old Ewan cannery. But as the community grew, they spread over here to Richmond, Lulu Island, to Annis's Island, and across the river into Sunbury. This would be about where the Alex Fraser
bridge is, just to get another reference there. All right.
There we go. This is Sunbury. This is Sunbury School in 1926, and here are 31 children pictured, and 17 of them are Japanese. So you get an idea. Their parents were good neighbors, and the children were friends together. That was North Delta. This is Kennedy School, and again, here there are 39 children, and 12 of them are Japanese. And this picture is from 1939. Finally, this is a nursery school in Strawberry Hill. All of them are Japanese. The Japanese were a very significant part of our community. Then the work, whoops, that one. The world
changed.
Yes, just go back. And that was Pearl Harbor. And on December 7th in 1941, Japan attacked Pearl Harbor in Hawaii. Then the next day, Hong Kong was invaded by the Japanese, and by December 25th, the Allied forces surrendered. Many of the soldiers were killed on the spot, and that included those in their hospital beds. They were called cowards for surrendering. Canada had 2,000 soldiers in Hong Kong, and only 250 returned. Many of them were in Japanese prisoner of war camps for that length of time. These two battles caused fear and suspicion among Canadian population. And the United States put pressure on Canada to contain their Japanese population on the coast. These events set a context where we find our Japanese in North Delta. John is going to continue. John McDonald will continue with their story.
So let's just go back a little bit to December 7th. William Lyon Mackenzie King was Prime Minister of Canada. And before that day was over, he and his cabinet had made their decision to declare war on Japan. The very next day, the RCMP began to arrest Japanese men who the Canadian government had deemed dangerous to security. Of the 22,000 people of Japanese descent living in BC at the time, the Canadian government had determined that a total of 31 were considered a threat to Canada's security. And you probably wouldn't be surprised to hear that there were people who thought that there should have been more than 31 names on the list. So the list was expanded and ended up with 38 names on it. And within about 5 weeks, all 38 men had been arrested by the RCMP and returned. These were men who had served in the Japanese Army, were official of local Japanese associations, or were judo instructors. And the next day, or the same day on December 8th, the Canadian Navy began rounding up 1,200 fishing boats owned by people of Japanese descent. This was done by the Royal Canadian Navy Volunteer Reserve that had been established in 1938. It was also known as the Fisherman's Reserve and the Gumboot Navy. Many of the boats were damaged or sunk while they were being towed up the Fraser. These boats are passing through the old Fraser Street Bridge on the north arm of the Fraser. The boats were tied up just past what was then the tip of Annecy's Island, opposite Annieville on the main channel of Fraser River. So Annieville would have been over this way, and
here, that's where the new Westminster Quay is today. And if you look closely at those first two boats, you can see there's about eight Navy Reserve people hanging off the boats there. In Ottawa, January 8th and 9th, there was a conference to discuss what to do about what was then called the Japanese problem. This is Ian McKenzie. He was a member of Parliament in Vancouver and the only BC cabinet minister in Ottawa. In 1941, he said, "It is the government's plan to get these people out of BC as fast as possible. It is my personal intention, as long as I remain in public life, to see they never come back here." This is Hugh Keeney's side. He was also at the conference, and he's the same Hugh Keeney's side who in the 1960s and 70s became co-chairman of BC Hydro. He was completely opposed to the incarceration and suspension of the rights of the Japanese Canadians, and he was supported by both the Canadian military and the RCMP, who argued that Japanese Canadians were not a threat to Canada's security. But the BC delegation, led by Ian McKenzie, absolutely refused to accept that position. They said they simply did not trust persons of Japanese racial origin, and they considered the presence of Japanese Canadians in BC to be a menace to public safety. And here's, I think, the most interesting part of their argument. They said, even if they were wrong, it made no difference, because after years of anti-Japanese campaigns, the people of BC could not possibly be convinced that the Japanese Canadians were not a threat. January 16th, the government ordered the removal of all male Japanese nationals as Japanese citizens from the coastal defense zone or protected area that extended 100 miles inland from the coast of BC. These were not men who had been identified as being dangerous to Canada's national security, just men who were still Japanese citizens. There was also about 500 men who were Canadian citizens that were taken from their families at this time. And Harold Miwa remembered what happened at their home on Vancouver Island when there was a knock on their door in February 1942. He said, "Some men, some Mounties, I guess, took my father away. Not just my father, but a lot of fathers." He said, "We didn't know where he had gone. They found out later, after his father wrote them a letter saying he was working in a road camp somewhere in BC near the Alberta border." The War Measures Act allowed the government to severely restrict the personal freedom of anyone in Canada, including the arrest and imprisonment of Canadian citizens without any charge being laid. And on February 24th, the government ordered the removal of all people of Japanese ancestry from the 100-mile protected zone. The BC Security Commission was responsible for organizing and supervising the relocation and internment of the 22,000 people of Japanese descent. These notices were signed by Austin Taylor, the chairman of the commission. And he lived on the large Shannon estate on Granville at 57th in Vancouver that's now been developed as Shannon News. All people of Japanese origin over the age of 16, regardless of their citizenship, were fingerprinted by the RCMP and registered as enemy aliens. They were required to carry an ID card with them at all times until 1949, 4 years after the war had ended. This is the old fairgrounds at Hastings Park where the PNE is held today. The man here in the picture is turning in his delivery truck. All of the buildings at Hastings Park, including those normally used for animals, were used to process and house about 8,000 Japanese Canadians between March and September 42, before they were sent to internment camps. At the peak in September, there were about 3,900 people being held there. This is the old farm building as it was in 1957. It's still there near the main entrance at the corner of Hastings and Renfrew. And if you were there around this time, like I was,
you would know that this man here with his hand up in the air holding a program was shouting, "Want a house, want a car." And you'd know that the Shrine Peonies Circus was being held inside the farm. But during the summer of 42, in spring and summer, this is what the inside of the farm looked like. There were beds for about 400 men on the floor and about another 250 on the benches around the sides. This is the present day view of the Peony livestock buildings, where many of us remember going to see the horses, the cows, and the pigs. In 1942, these same dusty livestock buildings that smelled of manure and animals were used as dormitories for the women and children being held there. And here you can see some women and children in the background, and these were their sleeping areas, the same places that had been used to hold cows or horses. These are Japanese men leaving Vancouver by train, saying goodbye to their families. They, the first to be interned were the men sent to work camps, to the road camps in eastern BC on the Yellowhead and Trans-Canada highways. It's not hard to understand that most of the men who were told they were being sent to work in road camps did not want to be separated from their families. And there were more than 650 who either resisted or complained about their situation. They were all labeled troublemakers and were first sent to the prisoner of war camp at Petawawa, Ontario, in Ottawa, and then to the one at Angler on the shore of Lake Superior. And 60% of those prisoners were Canadian citizens born in Canada. The first internment site in BC for families was at Greenwood on Highway 3 on the way to Grand Forks. It was established by the Franciscan Catholic Mission in Steveston after a successful meeting with the mayor of Greenwood. And here you can see the Catholic sisters meeting some of the Japanese families there in April. This is Tashmi, which is now known as Sunshine Valley. It's it was the largest camp, largest internment camp. At that time, there was a ranch there. This is on the Hope Princeton Highway. The highway now goes right past here. This is where all the housing for the Japanese was. And today, this barn is still there. It's got a big red roof on it, and you'll see that. And as you drive by on the highway here, this is the parking lot. It's now used for people to park their travel trailers. And I think Mark's going to talk some more about internment and after the war and some of his own experiences.
Which do I press to make it go forward? Left goes forward. Hi, everyone. Yes?
Yeah. I've read quite a bit about this the years. In the presentation, I know we're talking about the Japanese, but I don't see any white faces. I don't see these things occurring against Germans in Canada, Italians.
Well, you're right. You're right.
The questions after he's finished.
Pardon?
We'll have the questions later after he's finished.
Oh, it's going to be after. Oh, okay.
Yeah. All the questions will be answered later.
After we'll be good, but you're absolutely right. Two things. The presentation is about the Japanese. But you're absolutely right. Italians were interned, and so were Germans. You're absolutely right. Where to pick up? Beginning to turn left. Just to step back for a bit, when it was decided that the Japanese would be moved, they were going to be moved. They decided there would be a 100-mile exclusion zone from the coast. The Japanese had to move 100 miles away, and they were basically given five options. One was prisoner of war camp that John talked about. One were regular camps. Mostly in the Slocan Valley, but also places like Tashmi. Another were work camps. One was repatriation back to Japan. it happened very quickly, and people had to move very fast. You can see this picture of a family being moved. A lot of the sites that they came up with were in the Slocan Valley up in Caslow, New Denver, Standen, which was a ghost town. Basically, the government wanted to move the Japanese as far away from the coast as possible and in as inaccessible a site as possible. One original idea was actually to put them in old residential schools in Saskatchewan. What they came up with was moving them into Caslow. Caslow, it was a saving grace for places like Caslow and Standen, because they had existing infrastructure, old houses from the gold rush, that the Japanese could move into. And in fact, the Japanese ended up refurbishing a lot of this and saving some of the old houses that you see when you get to Caslow. What would happen is they would be put on trains in Vancouver, and the train would take them to Nelson. At Nelson, disembark, get on the Nasukan. If you've been to Caslow, you've seen that boat. And then they take the ferry up through the night, and they arrive in Caslow the next morning. Then from there, there would be buses taking them off to New Denver, because there's no road up to New Denver. This was where most of the families got sent. Not necessarily the men, because they were predominantly in work camps, but this is what happened. Another option was sugar beets. What happened was families didn't want to be moved, but if they had to be moved, they wanted to stay together. And one option for the Japanese to allow them to stay together was if they went and farmed as a sugar beet farmer. This was predominantly open to farmers within the Fraser Valley, but if you think back to the day in North Delta, North Delta was the Fraser Valley, and it was a farm community. So a lot of people from North Delta went, and it was a way that the families could stay together. They were already farmers, they already knew how to farm, they already knew the lay of the land, and this would give them opportunities. The war had really decimated the workforce in the prairies. They had lost 60% of their workforce to people being in the war. And so the sugar beets was a great way for the farmers in these places to be able to sustain themselves. This is, where's the pointer?
Or you could go mock and use the
No. So we've got Vancouver. This is the 100-mile exclusion zone right here. So you can see everything is behind the 100-mile exclusion zone. Greenwood, that John talked about. Caslow, Standen, Slocan, Popoff, Roseberry, Lemon Creek. Some of these were not actual places. They were empty fields. And they just put tents in. Tashmi, that he talked about, is right here. Tashmi is just east of Hope, just this side of the Hope Slide. It was the Trites Mile 14 Ranch. Trites was a mining engineer who made a lot of money out in the East Kootenays. Tashmi's creation was interesting. In part, it came because they wanted road work for the Hope Princeton Highway. In part, it came because they wanted to come up with a place where they could move men to a work camp with their families so that they could be together. Part was that the government was so successful in putting camps in inaccessible Slocan Valley that the white government officials that were in charge of it found it too difficult to get to it. And Tashmi was outside the 100-mile boundary, but close enough to the city that it was easily accessible. The sugar beets basically were around Lethbridge and around Winnipeg, and you can see all the different sites. They were in Lethbridge, they were in Picture Butte, Turin, McGrath, Raymond, Sterling, Tabor, Barnwell. and around Winnipeg, Marquette, St. Francis Xavier, Oak Bluff, Broomkilde, some of these small, small places that even today are unincorporated and have 20, 30 people. That was the sugar beets that allowed families to stay together and support the sugar beets. It wasn't just Canada that in turn Japanese. And as a quick aside, interned is the verb that we use to describe it. But in fact, it's against the Geneva Convention. You can't intern your own population. So Canada can't intern Canadians. So the Japanese who were born in Japan and hadn't become Canadians could be interned. But Japanese that had become Canadians or were born in Canada technically couldn't be interned. So they were held at the pleasure of the minister. But of course, the Americans had camps too, in places like Manzanar, just in the southeast of LA, and I want to say Tulku in northern California. The Americans, there was slight differences between the internment camps. The Americans actually created camps with barbed wire and gun turrets. The Canadians, because we were so good at getting them out of the way, we didn't need to have that kind of defense. But in the United States, Japanese began to fight and say, this is not right, you can't intern us, you can't take us away, you can't deny us our rights. In December of 1944, the American Supreme Court ruled that it was unconstitutional for Japanese to be held. And as of January the 2nd, 45, they would be free to go back to their homes in the 100-mile exclusion area. In Canada, that didn't happen. And then the war ended in August of 45. And it didn't happen. What happened in August 45 is that the government then said to the Japanese, you have two choices. You can either go east to Toronto, because they didn't want the Japanese to come back into the 100-mile exclusion zone, but they had made deals with people like the mayor of Greenwood and the mayor of Caslow and the people in Tabor, that the Japanese wouldn't stay after the war. So even though the Japanese had gone to these places and created a home, they weren't allowed to stay. They had to move. They were given two choices. They could either go back to Toronto, or they could be repatriated back to Japan. Repatriated is the interesting idea if you are born in Canada. But that's what happened. Now, in early 45, the Japanese thought, the war is going to go on for a long time. We're tired of this. We want to be repatriated. So any number of them signed up to go home. Home. Then the war rather abruptly ended in August, and the Japanese thought, we don't want to go. But the government said, you signed up, you have to go. So now we have a problem. They don't want to have to go home because this is their home, but they're supposed to go. The Canadian government thinks about it and come up with a rationale and says, if you're a Japanese alien, i.e. you're a Japanese, but you haven't become Canadian, you have to go home. If you're a naturalized Canadian, but you haven't said you don't want to be repatriated by September 45, you have to go home. If you are a Nisei, which means you were born in Canada, and you didn't revoke your repatriation request, you had to go home, plus all of the wives and children. So in fact, any number still had to leave. It wasn't until March 1949, so 7 years after the Japanese were interred, 3.5 years after the end of the war, March 1949, the government said the Japanese can come home. So the Japanese that lived in North Delta, that moved, couldn't come back to North Delta until 49. Now, the map that John showed you earlier of all the Japanese sites, especially on 88th, on 90th, on 92 especially was full of Japanese homesteads. And they were all chicken farms. And in fact, it was called Chicken Mura. Mura, the Japanese word for village, it was called Chicken Mura. And apparently there were big, tall trees, and you walked down the street, you could just hear the chickens and smell the chickens. Because they were farmers, most of the people on 92nd opted to do sugar beets. Because A, they could stay together as a family, and B, the logic would be, well, if my neighbor is also going on sugar beets, I'll be able to maintain that relationship. So a lot of people in North Delta opted to go for sugar beets. The map that John showed you came from a book, sort of a class yearbook, if you will, created by a fellow named Michael Hoshinko, who lived in Surrey on Jorth Road for the old timers. I forget what Jorth Road is actually called now.
108.
Of the people in his book, 15 of the families opted to go to Manitoba, 2 opted to go to Alberta, 10 opted to go to camps, 5 to repatriation. But of all those families, only 3 reestablished on the West Coast. And none of them in North Delta. And all of this is just history. And it's just numbers, and it's just words. And it's real interesting, and then you move on. And then I didn't. Some of you know this picture. I just took it yesterday. It turns out on Google there's only 2 pictures of Annieville Elementary. One has got a beautiful starburst over the front. Looks like it should be in a David Bowie video. And the other is from about 1940. I went to Annieville, it was my first year, it was 1966. We just moved here from Ontario. I was 7 and a half years old. And my teacher, it was her first ever teaching job. And her name was Miss Katsumoto. And she was my grade 3 teacher. And when you're in grade 3, you only have a teacher. Sometimes you don't even think of them as being men or women. Certainly not Japanese, they're just your teacher. And Miss Katsumoto was my teacher. And in 1966, well, that was the year the monkeys came out. It was a long time ago. But you think about what was on TV. You had Hogan's Heroes, and you had the Rat Patrol, and you had Combat. You had all of these things. I collected G.I. Joes. I loved G.I. Joes. Miss Katsumoto's my teacher. And we would go out. Our classroom was down here. We'd come up these doors and we'd play on a hard blacktop and we'd pretend to be airplanes and we'd run around at recess. And it never occurred to me, she's just my teacher, Miss Katsumoto. I remember one night we were in New Westminster at the Army and Navy. Miss Katsumoto lived in New Westminster on Fifth Avenue. A big high rise. And she lived in the same building as another teacher from Edinburgh, Miss Spencer, if you remember her. And her and Miss Spencer would drive across the bridge every day. It was Miss Katsumoto's first job. It was not Miss Spencer's first job. And just going over my time, but we saw her in the bottom of Army and Navy one night. And it was early December. And I was just excited because I saw my teacher. And she said, what do you want for Christmas? And I grabbed her hand and I dragged her around the corner and I said, I want, and I showed her this big wall and it was G.I. Joes. So for Christmas that year, I got that. The G.I. Joe Japanese Imperial Soldier. I don't think I'm backwards. Yeah. And it never occurred to me that Miss Katsumoto was Japanese. It never occurred to me. And then, as my life progressed, I ended up teaching in Japan for a couple of years. And I started learning more about Japan and learning more about history, but I never really thought that the Japanese internment was a big deal. I remember meeting a woman in a museum in Ottawa and her telling me about the Japanese internment, and I said, but it's not really a Canadian problem, is it? It's more like a BC problem. And I just dismissed it. And then one day, I did the maths. And I thought, if in 1966, Miss Katsumoto was my teacher, and it was her first teaching job, and you're 21 when you get your first teaching job, that means she was born in 1945. And the tumbler started clicking. Miss Katsumoto was not born in a camp. Her parents were farmers. The plot of land that they originally owned is where the Pitt Meadows airport is. Her father had come over from Japan. Her family was from a place called Yamaguchi Camp. It's Yamaguchi province in southern Japan, south of Hiroshima, right at the bottom of it. You can picture the Japanese mainland. We came from a very small little village. They got married, and then a week before they were supposed to go, it turned out Miss Katsumoto's mother was pregnant, so she did not come. But her father immigrated. Victoria, June 4th, 1928, arrived on the SS President Jefferson out of Hong Kong. And her mother arrives 5 years later on the MS Hiei Maru, third class out of Kobe. And they set up a little life, and they have this life in Pitt Meadows, and then the war happens, and they get interned. But they don't want to be interned, and they want to stay together. So because they're farmers, they have the option of sugar beets, they go to Manitoba, and they work outside of Manitoba. Winnipeg, as Ms. Katsumoto described, because I actually found it took a lot of work. And such was their life that they decided a better choice than having a second year doing sugar beets was they moved to a place called Geraldton, Ontario, which is 150 kilometers northeast of the lakehead. And they worked in Lottie's sawmill. Lottie's sawmill, I believe Lottie was a Norwegian sawmill owner in northern Ontario. There was a lot of Japanese that worked there. And that was a better choice, doing sawmill work in northern Ontario. At the end of the war, they moved back to Ontario, and that didn't work either. And so in the 50s, they came back to Abbotsford, went to Mount Lehman on Ross Road, if you know that. Miss Katsumoto went to a school just like this, Radnor Elementary. And I thought, when I was a student and I was getting my Japanese G.I. Joe, when I was playing Army, we were shooting down, one person would be the Messerschmitt, one person, and I thought, you know, I had no idea, and here's this woman who was born in a prisoner, in a sawmill, camp because of the war. They had been interned, and I had no idea. And she never ever mentioned it. Miraculously, I found her one day. It takes a lot of time to search when you only know someone's maiden name. But she's married and she's living in New Brunswick now. Her husband was from Steesdale. And because her husband's family had a certain amount of money, they were able to be self-sustaining, which was another option. And they lived up near Minto, just on the other side, up near Little Web. But their property was gone too. And it never really struck me about what happened until I put all of this together and related it to my experience with my teacher. Because there was nothing sinister about my teacher. There was nothing untoward about my teacher. She was this loving, kind, gentle, caring woman who just wanted to teach and be with kids. And that was our experience, and that was my experience. And it's that reason that it's important that we need to understand about the Japanese in North Delta, in our community, but in general. I grew up, I grew up right here on Kendale Way. And I absolutely, positively knew that North Delta had a Scandinavian heritage. And I did not know until a year and a half ago that any Japanese lived here, let alone tens of families, let alone having a Japanese school. I had absolutely no clue. I went to the Steveston Japanese Center to ask about Japanese, trying to piece things together. And the fellow I talked to said, "Are you from Steveston?" I said, "No, Annieville." And he said, "You know, Annieville's famous in the Japanese community." I was shocked. And he said, "Yeah, that's where the boats went. Everybody knows." And then I thought, huh, that must have been a real interesting Sunday dinner for Miss Katsumoto. When she says, "I got my first job, where? Annieville." Ah. That's really all I have to say. Thank you for listening. Thank you for all listening.
We're here to answer any questions you might have.
Yes. Okay. Anyone who wants to display on the screen and it shows the Japanese have ordered from the coast. Huge amounts of fishing boats, cars, etc. Yes, so now, when they paid for that, or what happened to all that, including the farms, when the war was over?
Are you asking what happened to the boats?
Well, did they get their boats back? Did they pay for them?
John, can you tell us about that?
Well, like the properties, that their farms, their 5 and 10 acre farms, they were taken by the government, and they were given some money for them. I don't know about the boats, but a lot of them were damaged. They had no homes to come back to. They had no property to come back to.
Most things were sold, and most things were sold for pennies on the dollar.
And my further question, I knew I was out of step because you haven't finished your presentation, John. Uh-huh. But I just wanted to know how many people of German origin, how many people of Italian origin, either born in Canada or immigrants, can you show us where their concentration camps were and how many they were in?
I know there were prison camps. I was surprised to find out the other day that there were 40 prison camps in Canada during the Second World War. And I read that when the Japanese Canadians first went to Petawawa, and I read somewhere that they had just emptied it of German prisoners. And I don't know any more than that, but there were. There were certainly Germans and Italians, whether they were Canadian citizens or German or Italian citizens, I don't know. But this is it. Just like with the Japanese, they didn't have to tell anybody. They had the war measures on it.
There's two things. One aspect is that it's not really obvious if I look at you. If you're Italian or German or Russian or English. But it's real easy if I look at you if you're Japanese. So that was part of the problem, is that it was more difficult to point things out. But in fact, when the original internment began, when the Japanese problem started, a lot of Chinese would wear buttons that said, "I'm Chinese." And apparently, there were some Japanese that would go out at night and mug the Chinese for their buttons. So your question is good. But
I can respond to the question a little bit. I'm of German extraction, or German ancestry, going back to the Franco-Prussian War. And my father was a sergeant in the Royal Canadian Engineers of the Second World War. Franz Welton Holland, like many other German Canadians. My father honestly believed that if the German Canadians had been more readily identifiable, they would have been in the internment camps as well. And I can tell you there were a heck of a lot more German Canadians than, say, Japanese Canadians in this country at that time. And he honestly believed that. And yes, as John said, Italian, I think Mark as well, Italian Canadians were interned. I wasn't aware that any German Canadians were, but I guess that did happen. Italian Canadians were interned up the Ottawa River Valley. Now that's where Petawawa is as well. So yeah, they definitely were interned, and they were prominent citizens in their cities and towns where they lived in Ontario. So yeah, it happened, but yeah.
This gentleman had a question.
Yes, I certainly know what happened to those Japanese boats. They were seized, as you said, and they were sold for pennies on the dollar because my father bought one of them. And even though that happened, I can understand the panic at the time. It, to me, the tragedy was when the government seized all of that property, they should have held it in trust.
Yes.
But racism being what it was, and you talk about Canadian, the Japanese that were born in Canada, well, they weren't citizens because they didn't allow them to be citizens, not until after the war.
Yeah.
And those I grew up with a whole bunch of Japanese kids who came back to Sunbury and became fishermen after the war. And, you know, there was still a quite a strong element of racism even at that time. But it gradually got better. As a matter of fact, most of those Japanese kids ended up marrying white kids. And as a matter of fact, there was a TV program on Knowledge Network not so very long ago about that very issue. I saved it, but I can't remember what it was called.
Just one point about the property. As I understand, in the United States, they did not seize the property from the Japanese.
You're absolutely right. I mean, it was a war, and of course there's fear, and of course there's realities of war. So this is absolutely understandable. But you're right. Racism played a huge part. When you think that Pearl Harbor happened at, I want to say, 10 a.m. December the 7th, which is 2 in the afternoon here, and 8 o'clock the next morning they were confiscating boats. So clearly they either did a lot of late night work or the plan was already there.
And then
by January, the plan was decided that the Japanese would have to be evacuated out by, I think it was April the 1st. So getting the Japanese to move happened very fast. But then whatever the rationale for putting Japanese into an internment camp for the war, you would think that rationale ended when the war ended. And it took 3.5 more years. And now I'm concerned thinking, I don't understand.
Yep. Another thing that has occurred to me as well about how well the Americans seem to treat their Japanese counterparts to our counterparts here in Canada is how you begin to wonder, well, this thought occurred to me about a month ago. Well, just exactly which country was the bomb dropped on? Because really, you'd almost get the impression that the bomb was dropped on Canada. No, it was not. It was dropped on Pearl Harbor, which was an American possession at the time. So that's a strange one. That's a real anomaly to me, that the Americans would have treated their Japanese internees much better than we did on it.
We had Hong Kong.
Yep, we had Hong Kong. Yes, we did.
That was
Winnipeg Grenadiers.